I wish to present a paper of mine that was recently published in the journal called Progress in Physics, Volume 21, Issue 2. The name of the paper is Observing Electric Currents in Space. I'm going to treat this like a conference presentation. I'm not going to read the paper. I'm going to try to give you a feeling for what sort of material is in the paper. As we often do in these settings, we're going to start with Hannes Elfin, who in 1977, he and his students proposed that if we could ever measure electric currents at the galactic scale, like these gigantic active galactic nuclei, we should expect to see electric currents that are between 10 to the 17th amps and 10 to the 19th amps. That prediction sat out there for about 40 years, and then recently we have now fine enough resolution for polarization measurements that we can look at these enormous jets coming out of active galactic nuclei. We can deduce the electric current involved, and lo and behold, it's 10 to the 18th amps in several galaxies, which is right in the middle of what Elfin and his students predicted. So how did he predict this, right? What I want to do is first answer that. What model is used to predict such things, and talk about a few examples. And then I'm going to look at what's called the coaxial current flow model, which is going a little past what Elfin and his students talked about. And again, look at some examples that sit out there already for us to see, and then say a little bit about what we could look at in the future that will elucidate the sort of structures and current flows out in space. What kind of measurements should we be looking to make? So how did Elfin make these predictions? Equation one in the paper is what's sometimes referred to as the Carl-Quist relationship. This is a mathematical expression of the energies involved when you have electric current flow through a plasma. On the left-hand side are the compressive terms. The I squared, that's the electric current. Electric current flowing in a plasma will create its own magnetic field, which will tend to compress the filament. That's a compressive term. The second term is also compressive with the G, that's gravity. We're talking about large objects here, lots of mass. Gravity is a very important force at that level. That's another compressive term. Now those should balance, if we have a relatively stable situation, those should balance with what are called the expanding terms. Those are the right-hand side terms. The first one, WBZ, refers to that if you have a magnetic field flowing along your current, along your filament, that can store energy. Magnetic fields can store energy, which means they resist compression. Another way to say it is there's an expanding term, an expanding force there from that energy. And then the last term, W sub K, is the thermal part. Thermal energies, random motions, always tend to dissipate and spread out any structure. So that's how you make these predictions. What's great about this way that Carl-Quist formulated it is that we can plug into it often quantities that are measurable or at least estimatable in cosmic settings. Okay, so let's go a little further then, the details of the current flow. What happened in 1950, Lundquist had this very short paper. It's just, that was back in the old days when a paper could literally be 3/4 of a page long and you could have a whole new direction of physics. And I think there were 3 references in the paper back in the good old days. Okay, so what Lundquist did, he proposed, what if we have current flowing through a plasma? What's the lowest energy way to do that? What's the least expensive energetically way to do that? Sometimes called a lowest energy state. Once you ask the question that way, you can set up some math and solve some equations. That what if question yields a mathematical answer. And those are in equations 3 through 6, which are the way that Don Scott formulated them, going further with Lundquist's idea. Figure 2 is what those equations look like, what I'm referring to as the coaxial model for current flow. You start with a current flow to the left. That's that center arrow going to the left. That might be all you have. But if you put more and more current through the space, it will start to wrap around itself, as you can see with those arrows as you go out into the different shells. And it eventually, those wrapping around will turn around and go the other way. So you can see 4 shells out is an arrow pointing to the right. That is the return current. We would now have a coaxial current flow with a return current. Do we ever see that? Yes, we do. The first thing I brought up with the active galactic nuclei, that's exactly what was observed recently, is that you have a center current, and then around it, you have a current of equal size going the other direction. So we see this model in galactic scale plasmas. Another place we see it is in planetary plasma. So go to figure 6. That's looking at the Earth. This is actual data of the electric current flow going in and out of the North Pole of the Earth. The red regions are current flowing out of the Earth, and then the blue is current flowing towards the Earth. And you can see these beautiful coaxial structures of in and out flow. The left-hand image is from a solar storm. There's a lot of energy flowing in and out of the Earth, so you have a lot of shells, coaxial shells. The right-hand side is after things settle down. You can see much fewer shells, much less energy going through the system. So there's two examples of where we already see this. The electric universe modeling of this would predict it, already predicted it. And once you go back and you look at the data, you're like, oh, geez, that's exactly what we said would happen. Another aspect of how we could make measurements going forward with this would be to use Doppler shifting of the emissions. Go back to figure 2. You can see for the current flow and the magnetic field directions that are going around the center axis. On one side, the arrow's heading away from us, and then as it wraps around the center filament, on the other side is coming towards us. So this is something to look for, either in new data, or I bet there's plenty of examples in the archive data from all the incredible telescopes we have. We want spectrographic data where on one side of the cosmic filament, it's redshifted, and on the other side of the cosmic filament, it's blue-shifted. We want to look for that as a way to build up the evidence for coaxial current flow in cosmic plasmas. The last thing I want to mention for how to apply these ideas to measurements is if you take equations, again, 3 through 6, figure 2, and you ask yourself, okay, I'm far away from the filament, and I have a way of measuring the magnetic field in the filament. And that's usually done through the polarization of the light. What would I expect to see? So if you go to figures 4 and 5, figure 4 is what if I have current flow just in one direction? What would I see for the polarization of the light or for the magnetic field? The blue is what you would expect to see along the filament, and then the red is what you would expect to see across the filament. On the right-hand side, figure 5, it's more complicated because now we have the return current as well. So the situation is more complicated. What if you were to measure the magnetic field of that situation? That figure shows what you would expect from the model mathematically. So what I'm showing here, figures 4 and 5, is here's a way to distinguish whether or not in a cosmic setting you have current flowing only in one direction, or do you have a coaxial arrangement of the current flow? So just to summarize, we have predictions from the Carl-Christoff relationship of the magnitude of cosmic current flow, which has been validated. Alfvén's predictions validated at galactic level, at the planetary level, at the interstellar medium level. Also, I didn't mention it, but at the solar level, currents in the sun, currents on the surface of the sun, all pretty much exactly predicted with the Carl-Christoff relationship. I then talked about measurements we could make that would show whether or not we have the coaxial current flow. And I also presented examples that we already see out in space of the coaxial current flow that's already happening in data that we already have. Thank you very much. It looks like we have a little bit of time left over for questions. So if there's any questions from the audience. Thank you.